Good afternoon. Today's topic is spatial analysis, introductory concepts. So today we will discuss quickly about the spatial data, what is the spatial data analysis, importance and different kind of tools and functions available for the spatial data analysis. So what is spatial data analysis? So if we see about data, so data means, if we talk about digital data, so data means something which can be used for computer operations. Here in case of spatial data, attach the positional values or geographic coordinates, so it becomes spatial data. For example, some population data is available, you attach with that population data the location of the population numbers, for example population of the cities, and represent it in the form of map, it becomes spatial data. If population data is available without the positional values, it is non-spatial data. So spatial data is the representation of geographic phenomena, field or object. It can be continuous data, it can be discrete data, it can be in the form of raster as well as vector data. Raster means data is in the form of pixels. Vector means data is in the form of point, line and polygon. So spatial data analysis is the process of extracting meaningful information from the spatial data based on certain requirement or criteria. So we are having some spatial data, for example we are having data of the city where ward boundaries are available, population densities of the wards are available, we are having land use land cover data of the city. So why do we have it? What is the use? So to extract meaningful information from this data, to extract the desired information from this data based on certain requirement, that is called spatial data analysis. So simple examples of spatial data analysis can be performing spatial queries. So queries can be of two types, spatial and non-spatial query. Non-spatial query means queries based on the attribute values, and spatial queries means queries based on location. For example, if road network data is present, point data of schools, colleges is present, and I want to find out the schools within 200 meter or 100 meter of the road on both sides, so such kind of queries will be spatial query. What is the nearest road, or what is the nearest hospital to my location, what is the nearest hospital to particular road. So that kind of queries are based on the location. So location based queries are spatial queries. Then comes network analysis, is also one of the very good example of spatial data analysis. Network analysis means here we talk about road network, finding out the shortest route from one location to other location, and service area analysis, closest facility analysis, such kind of analysis are the network analysis, and creation of surface from point data. So if you are working on continuous phenomena, so in case of continuous phenomena, source of data can be the satellite based observations, so that will be a surface already, but if the continuous surface has to be created for a continuous phenomena, in that case based on the ground observations, in that case point data need to be collected, and it cannot be collected for infinite number of locations. But since it is a continuous data for which you are working, so to make the surface, practically infinite number of point observations are required, but that is not possible. So in that case, surface is created based on the few sampling location. There are certain techniques, interpolation techniques, extrapolation techniques. Simple example, thin triangulated irregular network. So those are some of the examples of surface creation from point data. Making prediction is also one of the very good example of spatial data analysis. Predicting future scenario based on present as well as past scenario. For example, predicting land use, land cover in future, what will be the expansion of built up after 20 years, what will be the scenario of rivers or forest after 20 years. So that kind of prediction can be done with the help of spatial data analysis. There are certain modeling methods. So basically, spatial data analysis gives you the desired information, desired result based on the defined criteria. So now let's see what are the components of spatial data analysis. So if you have to go for spatial data analysis, the basic requirement is you should have the spatial data. Spatial data can be in the form of vector or raster data. There are multiple sources of spatial data, satellite based, ground based. And once you have the spatial data, a computer which is capable of performing GIS analysis, that is another requirement. How will you process, how will you do the analysis, where you will find out the nearest road or nearest school? You need a computer which is capable of GIS analysis. Then requirement, what kind of analysis you want to perform, what kind of result you want, what are different criteria, like finding out the nearest school or shortest route or whatever. That criteria need to be defined, and corresponding to that criteria you need an algorithm or a tool which is able to perform the desired analysis. For example, the software should be capable of handling GIS data as well as it should be able to perform shortest route analysis. So that way desired tool is required, and after performing the analysis some result will come. So how will you come to know what you have got? So visualization is another important factor. So after getting the result, visualization. So visualization is also one of the component of spatial data analysis, where we visualize the result, decide it is correct or wrong, what need to be modified. So there are certain different types of spatial operations. One is measurement, retrieval and classification of the data. There are certain overlay functions, there are certain neighborhood functions, connectivity functions. So we will see them one by one, what we do in measurement retrieval, then what are the overlay functions. So measurement, in GIS measurement, here we just talk about the geometric measurements only. Geometric measurements are basically the measurements which are based on geometry. For example, in case of point, only location of the point can be measured. In case of line, length can be measured, location of start point, end point, those kind of things can be found out. In case of polygon, there will be area and perimeter of that polygon. So these are some of the geometric measurements, because they are based on the geometry. There are other measurements also, like finding out the centroid, that is also based on the geometry of the polygon. So as well as not only geometric measurements, attribute measurements like queries can also be done in the attribute table, and queries are done basically in the query language SQL. So in case of vector measurement, GIS basically always stores the coordinate of the point. Coordinate means longitude and latitude values of the points are stored. So based on that, those latitude and longitude values, different things can be calculated. For example, location, length, distance. If you have to calculate distance between two points, you just need coordinates of those two points. In case of line and polygon, length can be calculated for line, for polygon perimeter as well as area can be calculated, centroid of the polygon can be calculated. Now another measurement is finding out distance between two features. Those two features can be point features, line features, polygon features. So in case of point features, it is very simple. In case of point feature, there is no shape, because point does not have any size. So, and coordinate of the points are also stored. So to find out distance between two points, direct Pythagorean distance formula, square root of x2 minus x1 square plus y2 minus y1 square. So this will directly give you distance between two points. What if they are two polygons? There will be many distance from this face to this face, or this face to this face, here to here. There can be many distances. One can be from this corner to this corner. So which one will be your output if you want to find out the distance between two polygons? So it is basically, in case of polygon, it is basically that minimum distance between two polygons. Not only polygons, if you find out distance between two lines, it is the minimum distance between two lines. So this was story for the vector data. Now for raster data. In case of raster data, measurement like location of the pixel, distance between two pixel, area of the raster, size of the pixel, those things can be calculated. So in case of raster, measurement is even more simpler. If distance between two cells need to be calculated, which means it will not be minimum distance between two cells like vector data, where the distance between two features was minimum distance, but in case of raster data, distance between two cells will be basically distance between midpoint of those cells. In case of raster, measurement is done from midpoint of the cells. So for distance between two cells, it will be midpoint of this cell to midpoint of this cell. This will be the distance between two cells. Area, if area need to be calculated here, since size of the cell is stored, suppose size of the cell is 1 meter by 1 meter and there are 100 cells in a raster, so area will be 100 square meters. Now let's go further. That was measurement types we have seen. Now we will see retrieval of the data based on selection queries. So selection can be done in two ways. One way is interactive selection, other way is selection based on the condition, and those conditions can be attribute conditions or topological conditions. So interactive selection means you just click the feature in data view, corresponding entry in the attribute table will be selected. Other thing, you just select any entry in the attribute table, corresponding feature will be selected, because attribute table and the feature in the data view both are linked. So interactive selection, this is interactive selection, selection by clicking, selection by mouse click, you can say that is interactive selection. It is easiest one. This selection is very helpful if you have to select one or two, or you just have to interact with the data. If you have to select multiple polygons, for example, if you have to select all the polygons, or if you have to select all the cities of India where population is more than 1 lakh, if such kind of selection have to be done, in that case selection based on interaction of the data becomes very tedious. So what to do? There should be certain condition based selection. So that is spatial selection by attribute conditions. So in spatial selection by attribute conditions, the selection condition is defined and based on that condition features are selected both, and the result will be displayed in the map as well as in the attribute table. So how these conditions are written? So these conditions can be written using the relational operators, less than, equal to, less than or equal to, greater than or equal to, or does not equal to. So how do we write these selection queries? So left side it will be field, for example population, then operator, you want to use less than, greater than or whatever, then value, for example 10,000. So population less than 10,000, this will be your query. This you need to run in the query window, corresponding entry will be selected. So for example, in this case, suppose there is one ward map, and for that ward some population is written, and now I want to select all the wards where population is less than 7,000. So now you can see, if I have to select all the wards where population is less than 7,000, if I will go for the interactive method, I have to see each value of population, is it less than 7,000 or not, then select, then go for further, then check. So interactive selection will be very difficult here. So selection based on condition, population less than 7,000, just write this condition, all the features satisfying this condition will be selected. That is very, this is very simple example. Now what else can be done? If this is very simple example, which means the condition writing method is very simple, so how to make it complex? Include the logical operators. Logical operators are AND or NOT. AND means if both the conditions are true, only then true will be returned. In case of OR, if any one or both of the conditions are true, conditions means these expressions which we are writing, if both of them are true, the true result will come. NOT means wherever conflict will be there, the true result will come. So let's see by example. Simple condition is also called the atomic condition, means where the logical operators are not used. So for example, if I have to select polygon where area is greater than 100, just one condition, so it is called atomic condition. Other conditions where AND OR are used, those conditions are called composite conditions. So how AND will be used? Suppose I want to select all the polygons, or all the polygons where area of the polygon is more than 100 and population is less than 8,000, which means if both of these criteria will be satisfied, only then that polygon will be selected. So let's see by example. Suppose I want to select area greater than 100 and population less than 8,000. So you can see the first entry in attribute table, area is 51.98, population is 7,932. So if you see, area is not greater than 100 in this case, because 51 area is there for first polygon. Population should be less than 8000. Population is 7900. That is true. Means if you consider this first entry, the second condition is satisfied. Population is less than 8000, but first condition is not satisfied. So since there is an AND, which means if both the conditions are true, then only selection will happen. But here in this case, only one condition was true, so there will be no selection for the first entry. Same in case of second entry, area is 86.98, which is less than 100, so first condition is false, and population is more than 8000, second condition is also false. Both the conditions are false, nothing will be selected. Let's see the third entry. In case of third entry, area is greater than 100. Yes, that is true, because area is 1045, area is 145, that is greater than 100, but population is more than 8000. So again, first condition is true here, second condition is false. Selection will not happen because AND needs both the conditions to be true. Let's see fourth entry. In case of fourth entry, the area is 651, which is greater than 100, which means first condition is true. And let's go to population. Population is 7630, which means it is less than 8000. So both the conditions are true, selection will happen. So now you can check yourself also for further entries in the attribute table. Wherever both the conditions are satisfied, the polygons are selected, otherwise they are not selected. Now how to use the OR? Suppose I am interested in selecting all the polygons where either area is more than 100 or population is less than 8000. Means wherever any of these or both of these conditions are true, I want that polygon to be selected. So let's see first entry in attribute table. Area is 51, but as per this condition, area should be greater than 100. So first condition is false, area is less than 100, but population is less than 8000. In case of first entry, population is 7932, that is less than 8000, so second condition is true. Any one of the condition is true, polygon will be selected. In case of this second entry, area is 86, which is less than 100, so first condition is false. Population is 8249, second condition is also false, so this will not be selected. Rest of the entries you can see yourself. Negative condition. Suppose I want to select all the polygons where ward name is not Rajpur. Suppose there is a ward file where name of the certain wards are given, but I want to select all the wards except Rajpur ward. So in that case, not condition can be used. Not ward name equal to Rajpur means wherever ward name is not equal to Rajpur, it will be selected. Wherever it is equal to Rajpur, it will not be selected. So you can see in the attribute table also, the second last entry, ward name is Rajpur, it is not selected. Rest of the entries are selected. Selected means this red color, dark red color is the selection. Now searching for the null values as well as not null values. So if I want to find out all the null values, so simply wherever ward name is null, means there is no entry corresponding to ward name. If I want to select all the wards where there is some entry, so ward name is not null, means wherever some entry will be there, it will be selected. Like operator. Suppose I want to select all the wards where name of the ward starts with RA. It can be Rajpur, it can be Raipur, it can be Rampur. So if I want to select those kind of wards, so like operator can be used. So ward name like RA, so it will select all the wards where name starts with RA. Percentage as well as star can be used here. Ward name like percentage RA or star RA means wherever name ends with RA, those entries will be selected. Other thing, star or percentage RA percentage. So here wherever RA is in between of the word. So these are three different conditions where like operator can be used. Now selection based on the topological relationship. So there are certain topological relationship means spatial relationship. So there are certain spatial relationships like disjoint, meet, equal inside, covered by, contains, covers and overlap. Based on these, selections can be done. So let's see them one by one in detail. So disjoint spatial relationship. Disjoint means geometries neither touch nor overlap, means separated by a distance. Means suppose there is one polygon A or one feature A, another feature B, one feature A, another feature B, they do not touch, they do not overlap. So this is the disjoint relationship. Now meet, there is another relationship, topological relationship, or you can say spatial relationship. In case of meet, geometries touch at the boundary but not the interior, which means two geometries touch from outside. Because if you say geometries are touching at the boundary, which means this scenario is also possible. Suppose this is one polygon and this is another polygon, they are touching here, but this is not meet relationship. Meet relationship, they are touching from the outside, this kind of relationship. This is meet relationship. So this kind of relationship can be between two polygons. In this example you can see two lines, polygon and line, this kind of relationship. Polygon and point, line and point. So this meet relationship can be seen in these five scenarios: polygon, 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 line, polygon point, line, line and line point. Then comes equal. It is very clear from the name, geometries are completely coincident. Means suppose polygon A is this, this is polygon A and another polygon B, that is of exactly same shape as A, same shape, size, orientation, everything is same. So that is equal. So two polygons can be equal, two lines can be equal, two points can be equal. So it can be seen in this case, polygon polygon means feature A should be polygon, feature B is polygon, you can find out the equal. Feature A is line, feature B is line, the equal relationship can be used. Feature A is point, feature B is point. So you cannot have like polygon polygon line, means you cannot have this equal relationship in case of polygon and line, because these two belong to different geometries. Polygon, line, they cannot be equal, they cannot be coincident. Polygon, similarly for polygon point or line point, they are different geometries. So this condition, if you see the definition, in case of equal, geometry should be completely coincident. Now inside relationship, suppose this is object B, inner one is B, outer one is A. So if object B is inside object A, so object B will be selected in this inside relationship. For example, consider polygon point example. Polygon and point, this one. Consider polygon point one. You have one layer where polygon geometry is there, and you have another layer where point geometry is there. So if I want to select, and the polygon geometry belongs to the states and point geometry belongs to the schools. So if I want to select all the schools inside Delhi city, so that will be the inside relationship. All the schools which are inside the Delhi city, in this case, all the schools in Delhi city will be selected. So in that case, this inside relationship is used. Now covers and covered by, we will see. So object A covers object B. So object A will be selected here. So outer one is object A. In this case, the inner polygon is object B. So in case of covers relationship, object A will be selected. This relationship can be between polygon, polygon and polygon line. For example, select the ward which covers IIRS. So IRS is situated in Dehradun city. Dehradun city is having many wards. So if I want to select the ward which contains the IRS, so in that case, that particular ward covers IRS. So the ward boundary will be selected here in this case. And if you see, in case of inside, the inside feature was getting selected. In case of covers, the outside boundary is getting selected. And covered by is opposite of covers. In covers, outside boundary was selected. In case of covered by, inside boundary is selected. Object B is covered by object A. So this again, this can be between the polygon, polygon, as well as between polygon and line. So this kind of special relationship you will not find between polygon point or line point. But if you see inside here, this was possible between polygon and point also. Now contains. Object A is completely contained by object B. So object A is getting selected here. Outer one is A, inner one is B. So for example, select the ward which contains the clock tower. So here it is completely containing, but if you see others, it was not completely containing. There was a touch also possible at the boundary. In case of this also, it is possible they will be touching. In case of contains, it is completely inside. So here it can be between polygon, polygon, polygon line, polygon point. It can be between line and point also. Then comes overlap. So overlap, it is very clear from the name itself. Two boundaries are intersecting, or two features are intersecting, two polygons are intersecting, two lines are intersecting, polygon and line is intersecting. So it is possible in three situations. Two polygons may be intersecting, two lines may be intersecting, line and polygon may be intersecting. You will not find line is intersecting with point or polygon intersection with point. Now let's see the some of the example where that special relationship is used. So here, question is, select all the schools that are inside some Raipur ward. So this one, this is the ward map, and the black dots which you can see, these are the schools. So now task is to select all the schools which are inside Raipur ward, and this one is this one, this is the Raipur ward. So what is the process? First select this Raipur ward. So there are two methods to select this Raipur ward. One is interactive method, just you select this ward by mouse click, or this can be selected from the attribute query. Attribute query will be ward name equal to Raipur. This ward will be selected. Now next is select all the schools which are inside this selected ward. So inside relationship, here inside spatial relationship will be used to select the schools inside this selected ward. So inside relationship can be used in such situations. Now let's see example of overlap relationship. So task is select the major roads that run through this Raipur ward. This yellow one is the Raipur ward, and the red color lines, these are the major roads, and the black color lines, these are the ward boundaries. So if task is to select all the roads which are passing through that ward, so in that case what can be done, what need to be done? First one is, since you have to find the roads passing through this particular ward, select this ward either by mouse click, means either by interactive selection or selection based on the attribute condition. Once this is selected, next step is to find out which road is passing through this ward, passing, or which road is running through this ward. So again, this can be calculated, this can be found out using the overlap relationship. So this overlap relationship can be between polygon as well as lines. So suppose if I want to find out the road is passing through a particular ward or not, in that case what need to be done? Overlap relation will be used. So if they are overlapping, which means it is passing, if road is like this or like this or something like this, these roads are not overlapping with this ward, this polygon, which means it is not passing through that ward. Similarly here, that relationship will be used to find out which road is passing. So you can see in the third map, some of the roads are selected in blue colors. So these are basically roads satisfying this overlap criteria, and they are satisfying overlap criteria because they are passing through this polygon. Another example. So suppose task is select all the wards that are neighbor of Rajpur ward or Raipur ward. Suppose this is Raipur ward, and I want to select all the wards which are neighbor of this ward. Neighbor means wards which are sharing the boundary with this ward. So in case of boundary sharing, let's go back to the meet relation. So if you have to find out the neighbors of particular ward or neighbors of particular polygon, neighbors means sharing the boundary. So sharing the boundary means touching from the outside. In this case, because the one ward boundary will not be containing boundary of other ward, two wards will be touching from the outside only. So sharing the boundary means they are touching from outside. Touching from outside means meet relationship. Meet relationship is possible between polygon and polygon. Now go to here that meet relationship will be used. So wherever the words are sharing the boundary with this word, they are selected. So these are four words which are sharing the boundary with this word, or these four words are the neighbor of this word. Now selecting features based on their distance. So for example, you are having a word map, and schools means black dots are the schools, these red color lines, these are the roads or major roads in this case. Now if your task is to select all the schools within 200 meter of major roads, means suppose this is major road, there are certain schools. If distance between school and major road is less than 200 meter, that will be selected. If distance is more than 200 meter, that school will not be selected. How this distance is calculated? As I told earlier, distance between two features is the minimum distance between them, because suppose this is one school and this is road, so distance between school and road can be this distance also. If road is extended up to here, it can be this distance also. But no, it is the minimum distance between these two features. So if minimum distance between these two features is less than 200, that will be selected. If it is more than 200, it will not be selected. So in the second map, you can see some of the points are highlighted in blue color, which means those points or those schools are within a distance of 200 meter. So that was the example for selection based on the distance. Another example which have multiple selection method. So here your task is to select all major roads that are located within a distance of 200 meter from a hospital. So here road network is available. Some buildings in the first map, you can see some dots, they are the buildings, the lines are the road network. So task is to select all the major roads that are located within 200 meters. So this road network contains major road as well as minor road. So within 200 meter distance from a hospital. So these dots in the first map, they belong to buildings. Those buildings can be hospital, non-hospital also. So first task is to select the hospitals from these buildings, because reference point is hospital. You have to select the roads which are within 200 meter of a hospital. So start with the reference point. Reference point is hospital. So select the hospitals. So if you can see, some of the points are highlighted in yellow color in the first image. Those are the selected hospitals. Now next task is select all the roads which are within 200 meter of these selected hospitals. So here there is one selected hospital, there is another selected hospital here, another hospital is here. There are 3-4 hospitals selected in yellow color in the first image. So now select all the roads which are within 200 meter of this hospital. So in the second image, you can see yellow color. These are the roads, all the roads which are within 200 meter of these hospitals. One hospital was here, one was here, and one was here, one was here. So all the roads which are within 200 meters of the hospital, they are selected. Now since our task was to select major road only, But this is the road network. Road network contains all kind of road. It can be major road, minor road, district road, village road. It can be, there can be multiple criteria. So multiple categories of the roads. So from those categories, major road has to be selected. So from here, selection was based on attribute condition. Hospital was selected based on the categorization in attribute table. Then from the hospital, 200 meter distance condition was given and all the roads are selected. This, which means this selection is based on the topological relationship or spatial relationship. Now from these selected roads, only major roads need to be selected. Means again selection based on the attribute conditions. So attribute condition will be applied over the selected features only in now from here to here, which means major roads from the selected roads will be selected. So you can see only few roads are highlighted here. In this case, they are the major roads. So this way, in three steps, you will get the result, means you will get the all the major roads which are within 200 meter distance from a hospital. Now that was the selection based on the topological condition, means retrieval of the data. Now sometimes in case of spatial analysis, it is required to classify the data as well as reclassify the data. So classification of the data or input data is basically done to make different categories or to remove level of details or to make the data usable. For example, if population data is there, population is varying from 100 to 10,000 persons in a particular area. Suppose, you know, suppose consider the example of ward map. In some ward population is 1,000, in other ward population is 1,200, in other ward population is 10,000. Suppose this kind of data is available. So in this case, if you want to visualize the data, it is little difficult to visualize the data and find out that which ward is having more population or which ward is having population above a critical condition. So in that case, it is better, means to improve the visualization of the data, the instead of having population in numbers, it can be categorized. For example, population from 0 to 1000, means for example wards having population 0 to 1000, they will belong to low dense wards. 1000 to 3000, they may belong to medium dense wards. More than 10,000 will belong to the highly dense wards. So this will give a quick and easy picture of the population distribution in the ward. You will be able to identify easily which ward are having more population or having very high population, and other which wards are having lesser population. So this can be done to visualize, as well as this can be done to analysis of the data. Not only visualization, the classification may be required in case of analysis of the data. So classification can be where this classification is used in analysis, land use, land cover classification, you can see. So satellite data is classified in certain classes, 10-12 classes, and that data is further used for modeling. There also requirement of the process, means classification is the requirement of process. You cannot run the land use prediction algorithm directly over the false color composite of satellite image. So in that case, classification is required. So if in some cases input data is itself classified, So in some cases, reclassification of the data is required. For example, let's see example here. Suppose the left map, this is classified based on population density. 0 to 400 population density is very low population, then low, medium, high, very high. This was classified in 5 classes. Now for some other analysis, I may be interested in only 3 classes, low, medium and high. So in that case, I need to reclassify the already classified data. So here the reclassification is happening. So this reclassification is based on the attribute information available with the data. So the same data is reclassified to low, medium, high based on different categories. Means here low will be 0 to 1000. Earlier low was 400 to 800. So different processes require different classification. So based on that classification, reclassification can be done. For example, in case of network analysis, to find out the shortest route, classification of roads in major road, minor road or national highway, state highway, such kind of classification is required. So in classification, what we are doing, we are assigning just a specific attribute. We are assigning codes based on the specific attribute. Codes means it can be nominal, means classes are, class names are assigned low, medium, high. In case of land use classification, codes are assigned, pixel values are assigned based on the signature of the image. So another example here is, suppose soil type data is available and this data is reclassified into soil suitability for agricultural purpose. Soil is of different types. There can be n number of types of the soil, but it is reclassified into soil suitability. Means earlier suppose 10 classes are there for soil type. Means suppose 10 type of soil is available, but out of them only 2 are suitable for agriculture, right? Or you can say only 3 are available for the agriculture. They are suitable for agriculture. Rest of the 7 classes, they are not suitable for agriculture. So now reclassification of this data will happen in suitable and non-suitable classes. So here the 3 classes which were suitable for agricultural purpose, they will go to suitable class, and rest of the 7 classes which were not suitable, they will go to non-suitable class. So now you will end up with only 2 classes, only suitable and non-suitable. Earlier you were having 10 classes, so from 10 to 2 classes. This reclassification is done because the classification of soil in 10 classes were no longer required for agricultural purpose. Only suitable and non-suitable condition was required. So reclassified in 2 classes from 10 classes. So classification in case of vector data, classification can be done without post-processing as well as with post-processing. What is the meaning of post-processing? So here, as you can see, if you see this example, classification is happening based on the attribute information. Whatever attribute information was available in the attribute table, in this case population density, the classification has been done and the symbological representation has been changed. There is no change in the data. There is no change in the polygon shape, means there is no change in shape of the walls. There is no change in data or geometric data, you can say. So because this is without post processing, just classification on the attribute table. So other thing can be classification with post processing. In case of post processing, what will happen? the similar polygons belonging to same class, they will be merged. That can be the post processing, which means you can see many polygons in this image. There are many polygons, or you can say there are many words, but you have classified them in three classes. Now if you merge all the polygons of class 1, all the polygons of class 2, all the polygons of class 3, so you will get this kind of result. So where all the green polygons are merged, yellow are merged, red are merged. So here you can say there is a change in geometry. So with post processing, change in geometry happens because shape of the polygon is changing, size of the polygon is changing. So with post processing, change in geometry happens. Without post processing, no change in geometry happens. So this classification can be user control classification as well as automatic classification. User control classification means you decide the class interval. You decide whether it will be low category for 0 to 1000 population, 1000 people, or low category will be for 0 to 1500 people. So it is user controlled. Other one is automatic classification technique, where you can two techniques are there are multiple automatic classification techniques basically, but here I will discuss only two. One is equal interval classification, another one is equal frequency classification. In case of equal interval classification, size of the class is same, means 0 to 100 will be one class, 100 to 200 will be another class, 200 to 300 will be another class, 200 to 300. So the class interval is same in case of equal interval classification, but in case of equal frequency classification, the number of points inside or number of points within a class interval, they should be same. For example, between 0 to 100, 15 points are coming, and next between 0 to 400, 15 points are coming. So this will become equal frequency classification. Number of points in a interval should be same in case of equal frequency classification. So let's quickly see the difference between vector as well as raster data in terms of this classification reclassification, not the general difference between data types, here in terms of classification. So if you are classifying or reclassifying the vector data or raster data, what kind of changes will happen? So does the classification of vector data changes geometry or topological change? No. Until you do the post-processing, or post-processing means merging of the polygons, there will not be any change in geometry of the vector data, because classification is based on the attribute table, and change in attribute does not change the geometry. So no change in geometry of the vector data without post processing. But in case of raster, there is also no change in geometry, because raster is the pixels. You do whatever you want, still it will be pixels. So even after classification, it will be pixels. So there is no change in geometry of the pixel, means there is no change in shape, size, orientation of the pixel. Post processing means merging or dissolving of the polygons. Yes, if you merge the polygons, geometry will be changed, area of the polygon will change, size of the polygon will change, orientation of the polygon will change. But in case of raster data, even if you are doing the post processing, there is no change in geometry, still it is pixels. Earlier it was pixels, now also it is pixels after post-processing. So there is no change in geometry of the raster even after post-processing, but there will be change in geometry of the vector after post-processing. So this was it for today's lecture.